हेलो, गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन. वेलकम टू द फर्स्ट क्लास ऑफ सीएफडी. कैन ऑल ऑफ यू सी माय स्क्रीन?
यस सर।
ओके. या सो मोस्ट ऑफ यू वर इन द प्रीवियस कोर्स दैट आई टुक, फ्लूइड मैकेनिक्स एंड मैकेनिकल ऑपरेशंस. सम ऑफ यू आर न्यू हियर. हाउ मेनी ऑफ यू हैव नॉट अटेंडेड एनी फ्लूइड मैकेनिक्स कोर्स बिफोर? कैन यू प्लीज राइट इन द चैट विंडो सो दैट आई हैव सम आइडिया ऑफ इट. ओके, सो अबाउट 8 पीपल. ओके, 9. ओके, या सो सम ऑफ यू हैव सम आइडिया अबाउट इट, सम ऑफ यू डोंट. ओके, लेट अस स्टार्ट विद द ईच टर्म इन दिस computational fluid dynamics. So let me start with the introduction of the course itself. We'll start with the last term first. Okay. So this is computational fluid dynamics. Dynamics may be most of you should know. So there is kinetics, or kinematics, and dynamics. Both of these come under mechanics. Kinetics deals with only motion, acceleration, velocity, displacement, all of these things. So let's say you know the velocity or you know the displacement of some particle or someone in space with respect to time, then you can calculate their velocity, how fast they are going, how fast is the velocity changing, and so on. So that all of that comes under kinetics. Displacement, velocity, acceleration, all of these things. And dynamics deals with what is the cause of this displacement, velocity, or acceleration. So what forces are causing these things? Okay. So let's say there is a thrust force generated by this jet engine. So what force is causing this displacement, velocity, acceleration? Dynamics deals with that. So here we are talking about fluid dynamics. This means this is a general, very general now. Maybe in physics you have studied about particle mechanics, particle kinetics and dynamics. So if it is a single particle, how many degrees of freedom does this have? Can you please write it on the chat window? How many degrees of freedom does a particle, point particle, have? Right. Yeah. So some of you have written three, that is correct. In three dimensions, a particle can move in x, y, and z directions in Cartesian coordinates, if we talk about. So there are 3 degrees of freedom. Okay, now let's say there is a pair of particles. How many degrees of freedom are there now for this system? When you have a pair of particles connected by a rod, let's say. By degrees of freedom, we mean that in how many ways it can move, in one sense. Okay. So now there are some additional degrees of freedom here, apart from these three in x, y, and z. So these x, y, and z tell us that the particle can translate in x direction, it can go in y direction, or z direction. Because it is a point particle, it was a point particle. Therefore, if it turns on its axis, on some axis, then it is not counted because it doesn't have any radius. Okay. But here, because there are two particles connected by a line, if they rotate now, you will see some motion there. So now this pair can rotate about x axis, about y axis, or about z axis. So now there are 3 extra degrees of freedom. So there are total 6 now. Okay. In this case, there were 3. So let's say you want to write the equations of motion for these two systems. First one is the point particle, and second one is the pair of particles. How many equations do you need to describe the motion? So you will write some force equal to mass times acceleration. Okay. So let me just write it here. M is the mass of that particle in the first case, let's say. This is a vector equation, you can see that. So how many components are there for this equation? There are three components. Acceleration in x, y, and z directions. Similarly, force in x, y, and z directions. So there are total three equations here to describe motion in three directions. And for the point two particle case, pair of particle case, how many equations do you need to describe the motion? So apart from these three equations, you also need some description of how they are rotating about each other or about some common axis. So you need in case, let's say, they are not joined by a fixed length of this line. Let's say this line can change its length. Then you need to write these equations of motion for both first and second particle. So you will need three equations for the first particle, three equations for the second particle, and three equations about x and y and z axes for this pair for the rotation, right? About all these axes, three axes. So there are total nine equations now here. And you can see if you have three particles, then the number of equations will increase even more. Now you know that fluid is composed of a number of molecules, right? And the distance between them is also variable, it is not fixed. They are jumping around here and there. So this is the picture of a fluid that I'll draw now. Molecular picture. So all of these molecules are moving here and there at very high speed. If you take some sort of average of the speeds, then you get the macroscopic speed of this fluid. So even if the glass, even if the let's say some water contained in a glass, even if it looks steady, still, there are molecules that are moving at very high speeds inside that container of water. Now, if you want to write equations of motion for all these particles, that is for this entire glass of water, how many equations will you have to write? Can you guess for, let's say, 18 gram of water? At least tell me for individual molecules. Leave the rotation part and all those things. Just for single molecules, if you consider one molecule at a time, how many equations will you have to write? So you have written three, but there are so many molecules. It is not just one single molecule. In 18 gram of water, there are so many molecules, right? How many molecules are there? Yeah, it is Avogadro's number, Na, which is of the order 10 to the power 23 करेक्ट? सो दैट इज 18 ग्राम पर मोल, दैट इज द मॉलिक्यूलर वेट और मोलर मास. सो यू हैव टू राइट 3 टाइम्स द एवोगैड्रोज नंबर दोज मेनी इक्वेशंस. ओके, सम 6 × 10⁻². या सो दिस इज प्रोहिबिटिवली लार्ज नंबर, यू कैन सी दैट. सो पार्टिकल मैकेनिक्स कैन नॉट हेल्प यू हियर. इफ यू वॉन्ट टू स्टडी अ ग्लास ऑफ वॉटर, इफ यू वॉन्ट टू सिमुलेट इट ऑल्सो, इवन ऑन अ कंप्यूटर, इवन ऑन द वर्ल्ड फास्टेस्ट कंप्यूटर विद लार्जेस्ट मेमोरी, इट विल टेक आई डोंट नो हाउ मेनी सेंचुरीज टू सॉल्व दिस प्रॉब्लम फॉर जस्ट 18 ग्राम ऑफ वॉटर. सो यू कैनॉट इवन थिंक अबाउट दैट. So in the fluid mechanics course, which I took last time, we talked about continuum mechanics. Where we forget about the molecular picture of the fluid. We assume that it is continuous no matter how much you zoom in. Okay. So there is no molecular scale that exists. So we said that it's all continuous. There are density, velocity, pressure, all these things which continuously vary inside a fluid. So if you consider this molecular picture here that we drew, here if you consider a box like this, this red color box, then there is a molecule inside it. If you want to measure the density here, it is the mass of that molecule divided by the volume of that box. Okay, so you get some density. But if you take a box here where there is no molecule at this instant, then the density there becomes zero. So it is discrete, it is not continuous. Okay, there are jumps in density that you can see, but in continuum mechanics we assume that density is continuous throughout, it is a uniform fluid. Okay, there are no jumps, there are no individual molecules. So assuming that, we can derive equations for the fluid, and it turns out that there are only 4 equations. If you don't want to consider the temperature variations and so on, if you consider an isothermal fluid, then there are only 4 equations that you get for velocity and pressure. Okay, and you can solve them very easily. Okay, so that was about a little background on fluid mechanics or fluid dynamics. Now, computational, it is very apparent what that means. So, these equations that we write here, either for fluid mechanics or for any problem, any other problem, some thermal diffusion problem or any statics problem, it doesn't matter which equations are those. We are going to solve them using computer, with the help of a computer. Because we have so many equations, and sometimes those equations cannot be solved analytically, so we are going to use a computer to solve them. And how we are going to do that, we will discuss in this course. So we'll start with some equations, and then we'll see how to solve them using a computer. That is what we are going to do in this course. Is there any question up to this point? Yes.
So actually, I have no doubt in that your thoughts just now, but I want to ask, can you please
Yeah.
elaborate about this semester? How will you, grading policy is the same, I know that, but the assessment, is that also be the same as previous post assessments and all that?
Yes. Yeah, so mostly actually institute has decided that all the policies which were applicable last time will be the same this time also. So grading policy, assessment, everything.
Actually, some of the students are new to this course because they have not done the previous course. So I just want to, can you please repeat the assessment part and all that issue?
Okay. So according to the policy from the academic office, we have to take four assessments. Okay. They can be assignments, they can be quizzes, or they can be like a live exam also, okay, where you can be monitored. So last time what I did was I gave four assignments. Take home assignments. You are already at home. So you just submit them on the deadline, which was about a week, okay, from the date I gave the assignment. So you will be graded based on the assignment that you submit. So don't be late in submitting the assignments because these are the assessments you'll be judged on. So the people who submitted late last time, half of their marks were deducted in some cases, okay, where there was no genuine reason. Sometimes you may get delayed because of some genuine reasons. Okay, so that is about grading and assessment. Yeah. Any other question? And in this course, even if you have not taken fluid mechanics course, it does not matter much. Because here we are not going to test you on how much you know fluid mechanics. But what we are going to do in this course is we are going to start with the equations and we are going to see how to solve them using a computer. So they can be any equations. Here in this case, we are going to take examples from fluid mechanics, that is all. Okay. So if you understand differential equations, it is good. Okay.
Okay, thank you.
So, yeah. So, how will you be taking classes and how many live sessions? And when you are planning to hold them. So I'll be taking one live class and one recorded lecture per week. Okay, that is 2 hours. Or there can be two recorded lectures. In that case, half hour, two recorded lectures. So one live class. That can be on Monday itself, like today. So is everybody fine with that? Monday will be live class and there will be two recorded lectures. Okay. Yeah.
Sir,
Yes.
should we have a strong background in programming for taking this course?
Yes, so strong background is not necessary, but some background is good. Otherwise, you can even learn that during this course.
Sir, which language will be you following mainly in this course?
Okay, so most of the people are comfortable with MATLAB, I think. MATLAB or Octave. So and we have a free license of MATLAB also, institute-wide license. So every one of you can access MATLAB. Yes, so one important question. How many of you don't have a laptop or computer or somewhere you can program? How many of you don't have that? Okay, so I assume everyone has a computer. Yeah, then MATLAB is good. Even if you don't have a computer, then even then you can program in MATLAB. So there is a MATLAB app you can use for your phone. And because it is a code, so even if you write slowly, it's fine. Yeah. So because not all of you know programming beforehand, so I'll take some examples. I'll code in front of you. Here in live sessions or in the recordings, so that you can see how to use MATLAB also. Yeah, but if you learn now, that is better. First few classes, we'll take some examples from fluid mechanics. We'll get familiar with the fluid mechanics equations and some background in computational, some background in how computers work and so on. How can they help us solve these equations? Because as such, computers don't understand differentiation, integration, all of these things. Even division and multiplication, they don't understand. So how can they help us solve these equations? What is the basic architecture of a computer? How it works? So all of those things we'll understand in the first few classes. Then we will start with the coding part and so on. Yeah, is there any other question? Okay. Okay, because we have some time left. So let me just introduce you to some methods of solving some problems. Okay. So first of all, we have experiments, or you can say direct experience of what is happening. Yeah, recordings will be uploaded on YouTube so that you can download in any resolution you want. You can watch in any resolution you want. Okay. So first method is observation experiments. So let's say you want to know what capacity of pump you will need to pump water to a 10 meter height. Okay. How much pressure difference should this pump generate? How much pressure it should add here with respect to this point? Then you can do experiments. You can have different capacities of pumps. You can make them or you can purchase them. And then you can do this experiment and record the height to which this water goes. Okay. If you use a weak pump, low capacity pump, it may pump only to this much height. Okay. And then by trial and error, you can reach this 10 meter height and you can report your result. That is one way of doing it. Then you have theory or analytical solution. So you can derive a relationship between height h and this delta p between 1 and 2 points. So you can do this using Bernoulli's equation actually. Okay, and you can calculate what delta p, what capacity of pump you need to get this desired height h. And then there is a third way. Computational method, where you actually solve for the flow equations, which are also known as Navier-Stokes equations. Where the variables are velocity and pressure, like we discussed above. Okay. And then you can calculate this pressure at point 2 and pressure at point 1. What are those pressures? And then you can calculate the difference between the pressures and report the pump capacity, delta P. So for this simple problem, anything works fine. There is a difference in cost, of course. The simplest one, the most cost effective way, is theoretical method. Computational method is more expensive. Experiments may be even more expensive. Okay, because you have to purchase all those pumps. Yeah, but if the pumps are not that costly, then computational method is more expensive because you have to have this computer to run these simulations. Okay, but there are some limitations to theory. For example, there are some integrals. If you encounter them, you cannot solve them. E raised to the power x square dx, for example. If you encounter an integral like this, then you cannot solve it. There are some differential equations that you cannot solve analytically. Okay, and there can be many examples that you can list where you cannot solve them further. Experiments may have limitations. For example, time scales, length scales. If you have to perform experiments on something that is very small or very large, for example, now you can see big atoms, silicon atoms under a microscope. But if you want to observe atoms below that size, then you cannot do that. And if there is something smaller than that, you cannot do experiments on that. If there is something very big in the length scale of galaxy or universe, then doing experiments may not always be possible. Okay. And if something is happening very fast or happening at a very slow rate, then also doing experiments is not always possible. Okay. Now we have high speed cameras and so on, but there is a limit also. How many frames per second can you go? So there are cameras with the option of 10 million or 1 billion, probably. I'm not sure. Frames per second. So these many pictures per second you can record in those cameras. But if something is happening even faster, then you cannot record that. You cannot do experiments with that. Okay. Computations also have their limitations. There can be errors in computation. So first your equations have to be correct. Need to be correct means they should properly represent the phenomenon that is happening. So the model that you are using to derive these equations should be correct. For example, if you use Newtonian mechanics for something that is relativistic, then it is not good. Okay. Then there are errors associated with computations associated with digital computers. So these are numerical errors. Okay. There are stability issues associated with discretization of equations that we'll go to later on. Okay. You can also call these slash or and. So there can be both. And so many other problems may arise. But in some ways, even if something is happening at a very fast rate, or if you cannot solve something computation, something theoretically, computational method can solve both of these problems. So computations don't have these limitations. That even if something is happening very fast, you can simulate that. Even if you can't solve some integral theoretically, analytically, you can solve it computationally. You can get an estimate of it computationally. So these two problems that experiments and theory have, computations mostly don't have these problems. There are other problems, but you can solve these problems using computations. So in that way, computations can help in those situations where theory and experiments fail. Okay, that is some advantage of computations. This we'll discuss in detail in next classes. Okay, is there any question? We'll keep it short for today. If you have any question, we can answer that and then. Okay, and there is one more thing. There are some marks for attendance also that institute has decided, some 5% or something like that, 5 to 10%. Yeah, so today I see that there is 100% attendance almost. Okay, thank you. So we'll stop here.